Today we're going to be dealing with the subject of patience, but I want to remind you that we began with this. When we began the book, I began with this slide. Our trials come to make us better and not bitter. And I want you to remember that. So many times we go through trials and difficulty and some suffering in this life. And when we do, it makes us bitter. It makes us angry. It frustrates us. And so many people are striking out in our society because instead of getting better, they're getting bitter. And I pray that God will help us to just get better every time. Practicing patience. Lord, give me patience and give it to me now. I need it right now, Lord. I can't wait. Give me patience. And sometimes we pray along those lines. James says, but be patient then, brothers and sisters. He says, brothers to all, until the coming of the Lord. He says, see how the farmers wait for the land to yield its valuable crop and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm because the Lord's coming is near. He says, don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you'll be judged because the judge is standing at the door. Brothers, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophet who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's patience and perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. You see, the Lord is full of compassion and mercy. And he says, above all, do not swear, nor by heaven, nor by earth, or by anything else. Now, when I read that, you're all saying, oh, I need to watch my language. No. We'll explain what that means in a moment. But don't swear by heaven or by earth or by anything. The only thing we have is the Lord. Let your yes be yes and your no, no, or you'll be condemned. You know, we live in a society that has an awful lot of time wasters. And the longer we live, the more time wasters we seem to get. We love the technology that we have, and we think that that helps us. And in many ways it does. It gives us opportunities to get a lot of things done a lot quicker than we ever did before. And I appreciate my computers and what I can do with them. But sometimes technology can be a time waster. How many times have you sat at a computer and wasted 3 or 4 or 5 hours? And you know exactly what I mean. I don't have to say anything more. If you've been there, you've done it. And so instead of using it for good, it was used to be a time waster. And sometimes that happens. One of the things that's hard in this world is for us to wait. I go to my doctor and I have to sit in a room that's called a waiting room. Does that not explain it? What do I expect? When I go, I expect him to see me on time? No, I sit in a waiting room and I wait until he's ready. When I go to a restaurant, there are 5 or 6 different times I have to wait. I walk in, I stand in line, and I wait to get a seat. Then once I'm seated, I wait for somebody to come to my table. And they're not there to take my order, they just want to know what I want to drink. So they'll bring a drink. And then while they're there, they'll probably hand some menus to us and let us look over what's on the menu. Then I have to wait again for them to come back. Oh, I'll give you a few minutes to make your decision. So I wait again, then they come back. Do you know how many times I walk into a restaurant, I know exactly what I want, and I want to place my order? Waitresses and waiters are not geared that way. I don't know why they call them waiters when I'm the one that's doing the waiting. not them. And the worst part of the whole thing is when they come back and say, "Did you enjoy the meal? I'll be back in just a few moments with your bill." And generally, I have some place to go, some place to be, and I'm looking around and say, "Where's my bill? I want to pay." And then when they finally do bring the bill and lay it down, then I pick it up and I have to go stand in line and wait to pay. Well, now you know where I eat. That sounds like a Frisch's experience or something, doesn't it? Anyhow, we wait. One thing that makes patience even harder to come by is when we're thoroughly indoctrinated in our society by things that make us believe we're getting them quickly. I drove one night coming home from taking care of some folk in the church, and it was late at night, must have been midnight. Hadn't had supper, I was really hungry. And one of the last places I usually stop, I won't say that, but I stopped at a local fast food restaurant that's open all night, okay? You guess. And the only place, I couldn't go inside because, you know, I had to go through the line outside in my car. I have such a difficult time, I'll confess this. If you're ever with me, don't expect to go through the line in a car. I don't use windows. I hate those things, drive up places. I can't stand a drive up place because I'm driving up and I'm sitting on my wallet and I can't get it out. My seat belt's there and I can't get my wallet. Then I get my money out, then the change falls down in the seat, and then I can't get, and then I get my food and it's in a bag. It may not be all there, and I try to open it and see if it's there and so forth, and everything's going. You got drinks to deal with, and they'll give you three drinks and don't put them in a, you know, container. And you know what I'm talking about. And do you need a holder for those? No, I got four hands, and you know, I just whatever. And you go through this, but I went through this fast food restaurant. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. You know, my experience was about a 30-minute experience. Now, all I was going to do is go home and go to bed. I didn't have any place to go. But I drove out of that driveway very upset. And I said to the guy, "Whatever happened to fast food?" I thought this was a fast food restaurant. "Well, it's third shift and we're having some problems and trying to get things." "Okay, thank you." You see, the problem is we're geared to believing that service is number one and everybody needs to be there to serve you right now. My air conditioner was out on my car, and I had it completely replaced last year, but it developed a leak or something, I don't know. So I wanted to take it back to the guy that fixed it. And he says, "Bring it in anytime. I'll fix it for you. We'll get it taken care of." Well, he's a great guy, but sometimes there's a lineup of cars, if you know what I mean. And I just didn't have a day to take it to him and leave it with him and let him put it, you know, this in it. So I went until it got to be about 90 degrees outside. And I'm driving around getting in a car that's about 130 degrees. And I'm saying, "My goodness, I've got to do something about this air conditioning." And so finally I drove in and I said to him, I said, "Listen, I'm here to get my air conditioner fixed. If you can fix it in 20 or 30 minutes, I'll stay. If not, I'll have to see you another time." He said, "Let's get it done." And he did it. But you see, that's our mindset. We want what we want, and we want it now. And the longer we live and the more we live in this world, everything that we expect to have it now. People come to me and say, "I need to talk with you." "Okay, when would you like to talk?" "Now." "Well, I may be headed someplace, or, you know, there may be something going on. I have a lot of things going on in my life. And sometimes my schedule's just busy, busy, busy." You know what it's like, because yours is also. Now. And what people want is here, now, get it done. Well, I won't say get her done, because we expect everything right now. Patience is a very difficult thing. But when we think of patience, I want you to understand a couple things. And I'm going to show those things to you in just a moment. But I want you to realize this too, that patience is one of the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, God gives to us 9 fruit of the Spirit. You notice I don't say fruits. These are not fruits of the Spirit. I learned years ago not to teach these as fruits. It's like the last book of the Bible is what? It is, listen carefully, it is Revelation. There is no S on Revelations, all right? Just a little information, make you sound a little more intelligent, because it is not Revelations. It's not a lot of revelation. It's one revelation from God. It is the revelation. And the fruit of the Spirit is one. I mean, of course, it's broken up into love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, kindness, good, and faith, and patience is one of those. There are nine fruit of the Spirit. But here's the thing. God wants to work every fruit of the Spirit into your life. He wants to give you every one of those. He gives you love, He gives you joy, He gives you peace, He gives you all of those. And when it comes to patience, God gives to you patience. You say, I'm just not patient enough. And we get very impatient with one another. You know, we call somebody up and I'm telling you, if you can't get a hold of me instantly, well, I called you 30 minutes ago, you know. Really? Oh, I'm sorry, I was counseling somebody, or I was having lunch with somebody, or I was talking to somebody. Well, okay, but listen, I need to talk with you. That's the world we live in. And so I'm setting the stage for you to understand that I understand who you are and where you're coming from, because everyone in here is the same way. Y'all are no different. I'm no different. That's what we expect of one another. And now we say, oh, I just love having that cell phone right here. Oh, this is wonderful. I can reach anybody anytime. But the problem with that is everybody can reach me anytime too. Now, is it good? Yeah, well, if you can't get me, then text me or Twitter me or tweet me or do something. I don't know what you're going to do, but you can get a hold of me a million ways, can't you? Just one way or another, you can always get a hold of us. But what that does is create stress and pressure for us. But we live in a society that says, now. Now, why am I laboring this? Because you need to understand that if you're impatient, God wants to teach you patience. But patience is not just dealing with time. Patience deals with endurance. And I'll show you that in just a moment. But one of the fruit of the Spirit is patience. And here's the thing. You don't have patience. You can't have patience unless God gives it to you. Because the Spirit of God has to deliver it to you. The Spirit of God gives it to you. When you say, God, teach me patience. God, teach me to endure. God, teach me to be kind and loving while I'm going through a difficult time. God, make me different. One of the things that changes lives is the presence of God in a life. It's the most amazing thing that changes a life. When people say, you know, I've noticed such a difference in him. I've noticed such a difference in her. It's not him or her or me. You know what it is? It's God. It's God that makes the change. And if I ask you right now, as you sit here, how many of you have been supernaturally changed by the Holy Spirit of God? Kenny just didn't wait. He said, me. Absolutely. See? Because that's the truth. We have been changed. But it's not that you're just getting better and you're doing better in life and you've learned to, you know, you get a little older and you learn. No, because sometimes the older we get, the more grumpy we get. See? The older we get, the less patience we have. The older we get, the harder we are to live with and get along with. But what Jesus does is so change your life that I love being around you all of a sudden. Where before, I wouldn't want to be around you. I've had people tell me, you know, if you knew this person before, you wouldn't even want to sit down at a table with them. You wouldn't want to share a meal with them. You wouldn't want to be around them if you knew them before. The difference? What's the difference? Tell me. God. Jesus. The Lord makes a difference in our life. And when Jesus comes into your heart, listen carefully, church. You need to learn this. It's so important. When Jesus comes into your life, when you kneel before that cross, and when you say to him, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I ask you to come into my heart right now. I receive you as my personal Savior. I take the blood of the Calvary that was shed for me, and I allow it to be that which washes away my sin. And Lord, it's done, it's gone, it's forgiven. And when that happens, there's a marvelous, wonderful change that comes into your life. But what is the difference? Listen carefully. It's the presence of God in your life. The Holy Spirit comes into your heart, comes into your life, comes into your being, takes up residence with you, if you will. He's living in you. There's a power in you now that you never had before. What makes the difference? The difference is, here's a person who's without God, without Christ, lost, undone in this world, will not bow at the cross, will not receive the gift of free salvation that comes to us. And here's a person who has learned that Jesus died for them, and they received that gift of salvation. And this person begins to change in their life because they're a new creature, and old things are passing away, and behold, all things are becoming new. All things. And sometimes you say, well, I know a person that got saved, and they keep slipping, and they keep messing up. Well, so do I, and so do you. But I'm thankful that one that is there to pick me up when I fall is covered by the blood. And God puts something in my heart that makes me come back and say, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. God is working with me. Be patient with me. God's helping me overcome my problems, my issues. And you know, one of the worst things that Satan says to us is, you're never going to overcome this. You will never change. You'll never be any different. Well, I want to tell you, Satan, I've got news for you. Jesus made a difference in my life. He continues to make a difference in my heart and life. And it's not me, folk, that you see. It's Christ. If you ever see anything good from me, it's not me. It's Jesus. Patience is a fruit of the Spirit. God gives it to us. And if you say, I need more patience, well, you're just simply saying, I need God to give me more patience. I need God to change my heart, change my mind, change my life. I need God to do that because you're a Christian. And if you need more patience, that's what you need. I trust you'll see that as we go along. What about when we have to wait? Patience is a fruit of the Spirit, but what about when you have to wait? You know what? He speaks to that in here. Do you remember what I read about the farmer? You know, my first church was, now I grew up in the city. I grew up in Dayton. I'm a city boy. Everything, you know, I jumped on the RTA and ran around town and when I was a kid. And, you know, I grew up in town, all right? However, I had opportunity to visit farms because we had people in our church that had farms out the way. Some from Germantown, some from different places and had farms. So I had opportunity to visit the farms and I'd go stay with my buddies and friends out there. Then, after I went to Bible college, my first church that I took was surrounded by corn or beans, the whole church, and my house was. The church sat here, there was a little dirt gravel road in between us, and then my house. And if you look to the left, there's corn. And if you look in the back, there's corn. And if you look behind the church over there, there's corn growing. There's corn growing over there. You look across the street, there's corn growing. Are you getting a picture? The nearest person was a half a mile away from us. The nearest home. So yeah, I was in farmland, okay? Well, I'll tell you something. These people had to learn to put up with a city slicker. Because I didn't know their terminology, and I didn't know their lifestyle, and I didn't understand what farming's all about. But I'll tell you one thing. When they planted that seed in the ground, they had to wait for God to work. They had to wait for God to send the rains. That's what he says in the seventh verse here, the bottom part, last part of it and on. He says, what about the farmer? The farmer plants a seed. That seed doesn't grow up miraculously, and the next day he goes out and picks the corn, picks the beans, picks whatever, the wheat, whatever it is. That doesn't happen automatically. It takes time. It takes time. And I want to tell you something. The changes in the lives of people take time. They take time. And the farmer says, Lord, I need rain. He doesn't get rain. Or he says, Lord, turn off the rain. I'm getting too much. I'm going to drown my crops. Or God, something has to change here. And God sends what he knows those crops need. Is the corn knee-high by the 4th of July? You know the phrase. Tell you what, this year it was like shoulder-high by the 4th of July, wasn't it? All the rain we've had and everything. God blessed it. But the farmer has to wait. And then later on, months later, he goes out and reaps the crop. Well, let me tell you what happens in your life. You plant a seed, or God plants a seed and allows you to do that. And sometimes the seeds you plant take time to grow. So when you decide today that you're going to be a patient person, that God is going to change your life and change your heart today, and He's going to make you more patient, that means you're going to be willing to endure. And I'll show you that in a moment. You're going to be willing to endure what God is putting you through. Remember, you want the rain, but God doesn't send it. Remember, you don't want the rain, but He does. I've had people ask me to pray for rain and then not pray for rain and do all these things, you know. Well, you get a little confused, you know. It's all in God's hands. Amen. But what I need to do is love God, worship God, serve God, and wait. When I was in the service, it was always hurry up and wait. You know what I'm talking about? But I just need to wait for God. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. Be of good cheer while you're waiting on the Lord. You're praying for people. You're trusting God for situations. You're looking for changes. Sometimes God doesn't bring those changes according to your calendar, according to your clock, according to your watch. God brings them in His own time. And God brings them in His own way. And so what He calls us to do is to wait. Verse 7 clearly draws that out, makes it clear. I will patiently seek Him, Micah said. We will come forth bearing much fruit. I will patiently seek God. And when I do, we will come forth bearing much fruit. Some of you want to serve God. And let me tell you what happens when people get real excited about serving God. I've watched it over these years, over and over and over. Some people say, well, I want to serve God. Where can I serve? They come in and you know nothing about their life. You don't know how deeply they're rooted in Christ. You don't know whether they're born again. You don't know who they are, what they are. So the Bible says don't lay hands on them too quickly. So you just kind of stay back and watch and wait and so forth. Others come in. You see the fruit of the Spirit right away. You begin to tell. It's different. But then when you don't use them real quick, here, there, someone else, they get discouraged. Well, I wanted to serve. They didn't want me to serve. Listen, let me tell you how you serve God. You serve God by showing up every Sunday. You serve God by putting in your tithe. You serve God by loving others. You serve God by putting a smile on your face. You serve God by giving of yourself to others. And when the pastor sees that, then he starts asking you to do things. When we see the fruit of the Spirit in your life, then you're asked to serve. Then you're asked to do things. That's how it all works. But it takes patience, and we have to wait. I will patiently seek Him. When I see people seeking God, when I see people changing in their life, when I see the fruit of the Spirit at work in the people's lives, oh my, then it's a joy. We will come forth bearing much fruit. When you wait on God, your life will be fruitful. Amen. I love you. I love it. Look at you sitting there. Patiently waiting for God. Patiently working things. Allowing God to work things in your life. What a difference it makes. Listen, this may not be the most exciting subject that I could preach on. And some of you are probably saying, well, let's see, where are we going to go for lunch here? Because, listen, when you wait on God, you will come forth bearing fruit. When you seek His face, and what does that mean? Here's how you wait on the Lord. You wait on the Lord in prayer. You wait on the Lord in communion. You wait on the Lord in fellowship. When I wake in the morning, I was talking with someone, they said, I don't know how to pray this week. I don't even know how to pray. I said, well, you know how to talk to me. Why can't you talk to God? Why can't you talk to God? Well, because, and let me tell you why. Because here's the thing. People get up in church. Oh, Heavenly Father. We used to have this one preacher who, and I'll never forget when I was a kid. My father was my pastor, but there were other preachers around, and every time he came to our church, he would say the same thing. I asked Brother so-and-so to pray, and you know what he said? Oh, dear Lord, Today in this house of worship, we lift up our Ebenezer. Now that's a biblical term. Today we lift up our Ebenezer. And I thought at that moment, I ain't never going to learn to pray. Actually, we would look at each other and say, what's an Ebenezer? You got one of those to lift up? I don't know what to do with it, my Ebenezer. Seriously, as children, we did. But let me tell you about prayer. Prayer is this. I wake up in the morning and I say, good morning, Lord. See, he's the only one there with me. Good morning, Lord. And then I'll say something like, and it's biblical, Lord, this is a day you've made. And dear God, I want you to help me to rejoice. You know, I'm lacking this, and I don't have that, and I don't know what's going to happen there, and I'm real concerned about that, and this is frustrating me. But you know, Lord, this is a day you have made. Help me to rejoice and to be glad in it. And then something happens in my heart. Then I begin to worship the Lord. There are times in the morning when I just break out into song. I'll be driving along, and I just start singing praises and worship to God. Prayer is easy. Prayer is simple. Prayer is not difficult. You just simply pray. You talk to God. You say, well, what if you called on me to pray? So you pray. God, we've gathered here today to worship you. Everybody knows that's present. You all know that. And Lord, sometimes we don't even know how to worship. But you know what we need, Lord? We just need you to touch us. We just need you to be here with us. We just need your help. And I call on you today to help me to learn to worship you. What's difficult? You express your weaknesses and all the lack of strength and all you have. God, I need your help. God, I need a touch from you today. Listen, prayer is not just learning some poetry or something such as that. Prayer is talking to God. It's exactly what it is. And what a joy it is. I never go out of the presence of God. I'm always in the presence of God. So are you. You understand that? But you know what? When we seek him, Micah says, we will come forth bearing fruit. Oh, can I just make a point of that? You say, well, okay, all right, we kind of get it. But do you really? I want to tell you this. One of the reasons you don't bear much fruit is because you don't seek the Lord. You're not seeking God. If you're seeking God and you're in tune with him and you're praying to him every day and you're talking to him, you know, I don't get, some people say, well, you need to read one chapter in the morning, one chapter in the evening, one verse here, one there. Listen, I get up, I open my Bible, I say, Lord, I don't know what you have for me. Sometimes he gives me a verse. Sometimes he gives me five or six words. And that's all I can deal with that day because his spirit begins to work with those words, those thoughts, that idea. And God sends something home to my heart, and I have to pray about it. And it isn't just reading a whole chapter and setting. I know people who read it. I knew a fellow who would read through the Bible every year, and he would read a chapter in the morning and a chapter in the evening. And I want to tell you something. He was a miserable old guy, and everybody around him knew it. And he's read through the Bible I don't know how many times. And he's a miserable old guy. He's passed away since. Nobody really liked him. You can read your Bible all day. You can spend 8, 10, 12, 15 hours reading your Bible. Fall asleep, get up and read it again. Eat a hamburger while you're reading. Do whatever you want to do. It doesn't change anything until you say, Lord, this is your word. This is your word. By your Spirit, let me change. By your Spirit, let it help me and strengthen me and change me. That's when God starts working in your life. It's got to be your heart attitude. We need to move along. What about when people mistreat you? Let's see. Be patient. Patient? When people mistreat me? I don't quite understand this. What are you talking about? Well, God says be slow to anger. Slow. I guess that kind of deals with patience in a sense. What do you do when people mistreat you? Verse 10 tells us, it says, my brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. What do you think about Job? What do you think about Job? Have you ever really studied the book of Job? You need to read it. And not just so you'll learn greater patience, but I read it recently and I've been learning so many different things about Job. And I thought about Job and I thought, you know, God had a conversation with Satan. And Satan came to God and said, I'm going to take your servant. What about Job? He'll fall. And God said to him, you can take everything away from him, but you can't take his life. Now, Job was a very wealthy man, had everything you could imagine, had a wonderful life, had everything you could imagine. And God began to take things one by one by one. Now, here's the interesting thing. There's nowhere in that passage that tells me that Job knew that God and Satan had a conversation. Do you hear this? Come on, church, do you hear it? There's no place in that passage that tells me that Job knew that God and Satan had a conversation. There's no place in there that tells me that Job knew he was being spiritually tested. Nowhere. You see, here's the thing. Job had set his heart on serving God. Job had set his heart on being a faithful servant to God. And that was it. His heart was set. And his heart was set so that no matter what happened, you see, Job was living the good times. He was living the high life, the good life. Everything was wonderful in his life. So what happened when it all got taken away? What happened when difficulties came? What happened when the struggles came? What happened when things happened in his life he couldn't understand? What happened when he started breaking down mentally, emotionally, and all these things, and physically, and his body's getting boils, and all these things are happening? What's happening? Did he turn to God and say, God, how could you do this? I thought you were my friend. Why do you allow these things in my life, as you and I sometimes do? Huh? No, he didn't. His wife said to him, why don't you just curse God and die? He turned around and said, though he slay me, woo! Though he slay me, though he take my life, I'll still love him, I'll still serve him, I'll still be his. I'll still be his. Job. Wow. You see, the thing is this. Patience means to endure under pressure, under stress, under difficulties, under problems. Anybody can endure when your bank account is flush and your car's running great and you just got a relatively new one and your house is all working fine and everything's in order and your kids are telling you they love you every day and everything's just fine. And all your grandkids are doing exactly what you want them to do and everybody's doing wonderfully. It's easy to be happy then. It's easy when life goes the way you want it to go. But what happens when life takes a turn? What happens when things change? What happens when difficulty comes? What happens when you get sick? What happens when those around you are hurting? I want you to pray for a friend of mine. His name is Joe. Not this Joe. A Joe in Florida. A man I've known for many, many years. He's a funeral director. Took a fall the other day. And he's on Coumadin. It's kind of dangerous, and it's interesting because his daughter was in the house, and his daughter had been in the shower and just came out of the shower like 2 minutes before this happened. She heard her dad fall. And when she heard her dad fall, she ran into the room to find out that he was profusely bleeding from this left ear. It was squirting. He fell back and hit a bookcase and took his ear completely off and severed an artery. Joe would be dead right now if she hadn't been there and if all that circumstances hadn't happened and everything. They rushed him by helicopter to Gainesville from Leesburg, and he's recovering. His name is Joe. Pray for him and pray for his family, if you will. Tough situation. But what happens when those things happen in our lives? What happens? God, how could this happen? Now the man's without an ear. What are they going to do? Would you like to face the rest of your life without an ear? Well, maybe there's a plastic surgeon that can kind of do something. It's going to be 5 or 6 or 7 surgeries and all kind of things going on in his life. Difficulties. What happens? Can you still say, this is the day the Lord has made and I will rejoice and be glad in it? Can you say, though my funds are low and everything's happening, that I can rejoice? Can you? You see, it means to endure. Get it. Get it. This is what patience means. Write it down. Patience is not waiting in line and putting up with that when you don't have any place to go anyhow, probably. Patience is enduring under pressure. Job had the pressure put on. He was stressed in every area of his life. He lost everything, including his health. Why do we need patience? Well, there it is. Because if you're going to live for Jesus, you're going to suffer. If I would ask you how many of you are living for Jesus, and I saw hands go up in here, and then I would ask you how many of you are suffering, I would probably see the same number of hands go up. Because you can live for Jesus and still go through difficulties. But can you deal with it? Can you still hold your head up? Can you still rejoice? Can you still be thankful? Can you still face everyone out here in society and put a smile on your face and still say, Jesus loves me? God still loves me? And no matter what God does, no matter how difficult it is, I'm still going to love him and serve him? Can we do that? Because you see, patience, in the sense of this word, means endurance under trials and difficulties and hard times. Because if we live for Jesus, we're going to suffer. Jesus said, in this world, you're going to have tribulation. I'm so looking to go to heaven, be with the Lord. I may not go today, and I don't know. But I'll tell you this, I'm looking forward to going to heaven to be with the Lord. I am. And first of all, yeah, I want to see my mom and my dad and all the other people. But you know who I want to see? I want to see Jesus, the one that died for me. I want to look on his face. I want to see him. And I want to thank him. And I want to bow down before him. And I want to fall on my face and thank him for saving this rotten old guy. I'm so thankful that he put up with me all these years. I'm so thankful that he endured the cross for me. That he was patient on that cross for me. And you know what I want to do? I want to learn patience. Be careful, because when you pray for patience, God's going to see that you learn patience. We can have patience because we know that God will reward us. Matthew chapter 5 tells us that. God rewards those who learn these things. You can write that down. What about when you don't know why? Job didn't know why. Nothing in Scripture tells us that he knew why. Verse 11 in this passage says, count them blessed who endured. You see, there's Job. He didn't know why. So don't just think that he knew why, that he understood. He didn't know why. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. And Job said, may the name of the Lord be praised. Do you know that everything you have and everything you are was given to you by God? It's a gift. So if God takes it, don't worry about it. He'll turn around and give you more. He'll bless you. Remember who's in control. Not you. Because if you're in control, you're going to make a mess of it anyhow. God is in control, right? All right. Why does God allow his children to suffer? That's always a question that people ask me. Why does God allow his children to suffer? In order to bring us where he can use us. The only time you're going to learn to walk is when you're in the valley. You can't learn to walk on a mountaintop. When things are going well, that's not when you learn to walk. That's not when you will learn the ways of the Lord. That's not when you learn His love. That's not when you learn He strengthens you. That's not when you learn those things that are present in the Holy Spirit living within you. They awaken and come alive when you're down, when you're hurting, when you're going through difficulties. I learn He is my peace because the world's not giving me peace. And the only peace I can find is in Jesus. And my faith is grounded in Him. I trust Him. Nothing that He will do will harm me. We need to move along. Romans 8:28 says this. Oh, I know it says that, Pastor. I can quote that verse. Well, I'm blessed you can quote it. Let me ask you this. Are you living it? You know, Satan knows the scriptures too and trembles. Lots of people know the scriptures. And we know. You know what that word means? Doesn't mean you know up here. It means by experience, you can understand. You see, it's by faith that we know that all things work together for good to those that love Him. He's working things together for good. You say, well, what about this and what about that? And I'm asking you to pray for that, and this is hurting and this is going. Listen, God is working all things together for good because you love Him, because you trust Him. Job said, I love you, Lord, and I'm going to love you, Lord, and I'm going to serve you, Lord, no matter what happens, even if you take my life. And those who have been called according to His purpose. Can I just say, it's according to His purpose and not yours? Oh, Lord, help me with this, help me with that. I want to feel better. I want to do this. Listen, get over yourself. Get over yourself and say, Lord, I want you to do in my life whatever you want to do. I want to learn today what patience means. And Lord, whatever you send my way, you will give me strength to overcome it. You will give me the strength to walk through it. You will give me what I need to make it through. He will. That's what God wants to do. Well, if you're looking at your watch, you're saying, okay, Pastor, it's time to stop. You're over a couple of minutes. But I want to tell you something. God wants you to learn this. God wants you to learn this. I'll look at every one of you. God wants you to learn this. He wants you to learn this. This is His truth. And if you don't learn it, listen carefully, church. Let me tell you something. Mark, if you don't learn it, listen. If you don't learn it, Randy, if you don't learn it, Mike, if you don't learn it, listen. Here's what He's going to do. He's going to find a way to make you learn. Are you hearing me? He's going to find a way to make you learn it. Do you know why? Because He teaches us by His Spirit, day in and day out. And sometimes we have more struggles and more troubles because we didn't learn from the last ones. We know that all things work together for good to those that love the Lord. See, that's where it begins. You know what you need to say this morning? You need to bow your head right now and say to Him, Lord Jesus, I love you. But only say if you mean it in your heart. Lord Jesus, I love you. And I know that you live within me. And I know, Lord Jesus, that everything that touches my life is filtered through your love for me. And I know that you want to use my life to reach others and to bless others and help others. And so, Lord Jesus, right now, I'm saying yes to you. And I'm giving you permission to do whatever you wish to do in my heart and in my life to make me what you want me to be. Bless me, Lord, that my life will be a blessing to others. Father, make this real to us tonight. We're loaded with burdens. We're loaded with problems. But you know every one of them. And you're the one who bears those burdens for us. And Lord, I thank you that you teach us these things. Grant it that each one of us will learn patience today. Bless us, Lord. I pray, dear Father, if there's one person here today who's never experienced the touch of God, who's never experienced salvation through Jesus Christ, that they will not leave this place today before they talk with someone about coming to know Christ as Savior. And I pray, Father, that each one of us will go out of here different than we came in. Thank you. It's been a precious morning. We love you. We thank you for this time together. Lord, lead us throughout this week into pastures that will lead others to Jesus Christ. Bless our lives that we will be a blessing. Use us to your glory. Father, for every good and perfect thing that you do for us and give to us, we will return to praise you and give you glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.